especially glad to see you this evening. Thank you so much for joining us. This is a historic week at the Space and Rocket Center. Unless my memory is poor, or I don't have complete information, this is the busiest week of our entire 46-year history at the Space and Rocket Center. I tell you, just a couple of things that are going on this week, just to let you know how our life is here. We're still the state's number one tourist attraction with record attendance this year. We just finished our NASA STEM Education Teachers Program. We have with us many of the 50 Teachers of the Year from each state in our union, so you might look and find the Teacher of the Year from your state. We also have International Space Camp going on this week. They just graduated right in this auditorium a few minutes ago, so we have 17 countries from which a teacher brought two students with them to interface with our 50 Teachers of the Year. We have our alumni weekend coming up, starting just this evening. The Beer Garden always kicks off the alumni weekend every year. We have now 750,000 graduates of Space Camp. So we have to have reunion. That's an awful lot of graduates. And I'm here to tell you, we're also very proud to say that one of those graduates is circling above us right now on the International Space Station. She's cool. She is definitely cool. So Saturday night we'll be having a big concert out under the shuttle. We are sold out in Space Camp in June and July for the first time in 30 years, which is very exciting for us financially to have that happen. And we have 894 students here from all over the world. We had last year 70 foreign countries, and all 50 states and the three possessions have gone to Space Camp. So it is a really big week. It is also, of course, the introduction of our book from the Space and Rocket Center, The Greatest Space Generation, as inspired by Wernher von Braun. And to top it all off, today we introduce our first beer. Oh yeah. Uh-huh. It's called T-. Isn't that a great name? It is a tangerine Kolsch produced for us by the Yellowhammer Brewery here. And it's an homage to Tang with the tangerine Kolsch. It's a delicious beer, and it is for sale tonight after you finish the lecture series, or during the series, if you'd like to go on out there and have a beer while you're watching the panel. Say again? Oh, it's not on Space Station yet. Not yet. It's just tonight is its premiere. It's the first night. You know, Dr. von Braun, for us here at the Space and Rocket Center, this almost feels, frankly, not to be sacrilegious, but to me personally, this feels like church. Whether you come together with your friends in nature to commune and to be inspired, or whether you come together in your church family or your home family or family reunions like our alumni reunion this weekend, we've come together here in this Pass the Torch series for inspiration and to inspire one another about the future. For some of us, I have to be honest with you, Dr. von Braun is a mentor, for me personally, a hero. I feel that I am devoting my life's work to continuing the work that he envisioned originally. And I think he would be amazed today, 32 years later, to see the far-reaching effects of his vision. Most of you know the story, but for those who don't, Dr. von Braun was walking through our rocket park one day with Ed Buckbee. And he said, you know, we got band camp, cheerleading camp, and football camp. Why can't we have a science camp? Why can't we have a space camp? And I think if he were here to see the 750,000 people have gone through his program, more than 5,000 teachers from around the world have been inspired by his vision. One of the most visionary things that he did was to select the first director of this museum. That man is Ed Buckbee. I went to work for him when I was 19 years old. I have been inspired every day of my life from working here. And this, as you may know, is my fourth time to come back and work at this rocket center. But Dr. von Braun made a very good choice that day. He selected Ed Buckbee to start this institution and this enterprise, to work through the pains of birth with the state of Alabama and the Army and everybody else that had to be convinced this was a great idea. And then he led it with all his heart for 26 years. Ladies and gentlemen, my friend, my mentor, and the first director of the U.S. Space and Rocket Center, Ed Buckbee.
And Deborah, I was 21 years old. I want to thank you for a great introduction, and especially the opportunity to be involved with Pass the Torch program for us, involved in this book, because it's a very special program here, and we're very pleased to be participating. Every time I walk through the hall under that Saturn V, I'm reminded of a meeting we had in 1969 where we brought the crew together who had assembled the parts of the Saturn V. And we were preparing to move that Saturn V out here and put it on display. Everything was well organized. Everybody stood up and gave their presentations. But then one guy got up and said, "We don't have permission from NASA headquarters to move this rocket off of the center and take it to the Space and Rocket Center." All of a sudden, everyone looked toward a man by the name of Warner Von Braun. And Warner Von Braun said, "It's easier to get forgiveness than permission from Washington, D.C. Proceed." And we did. The book, The Greatest Space Generation, is really about the people who developed the Saturn V machine on display in this building. And they came from nearly every state in this union. And this was in the 1950s and the 1960s. And they wanted to work at that challenging place called Redstone Arsenal, the military facility that was just being created to do research and work on missiles. And by the way, they just recently celebrated their 75th birthday at the Redstone Arsenal complex. A little did they know how challenging and exciting the future would become as they moved into this, what we called manned spaceflight business at the Marshall Space Flight Center. They were challenged by a young president by the name of John Kennedy. They were inspired by rocket scientist Warner Von Braun. They designed and developed the Saturn V moon rocket. Not just a rocket, but an exploration vehicle that took Americans to another body in our system. And Von Braun was the leader with that versatility that leaders must possess. He was the master of his machines, but he realized those rockets could only be successful as the people who built them. And, ladies and gentlemen, he assembled an extraordinarily talented team of men who are, many of them are with us this evening, who developed the Saturn V moon rocket. The foreword of this book was written by Apollo 17 astronaut Harrison Schmitt, first scientist on the moon and the last astronaut to step on the moon. The book consists of five main chapters: the beginning, organization, management, marketing, and reflections. And I would like to, at this time, thank the contributors, and please ask them to stand and be recognized in the audience. And we have a visual to bring those names up. So all of you that participated as a contributor to the book, please stand at this time. Thank you. And I must not overlook the publisher, Acclaim Press. Randy Bumgardner, please stand. The editor. Now, this poor guy had to edit my material, not to mention 20 engineers' material. Now it's my pleasure to introduce the panelists who will discuss their contribution to the book. I'll begin with Jay Foster, a mechanical engineer who joined the Von Braun team in 1955 as a GI at Redstone Arsenal. He began his career at Marshall's manufacturing engineering area. Von Braun picked him to serve on his personal staff in 1961. After the first moon landing, Von Braun again selected him to join the team at NASA headquarters in developing the nation's long-range manned spaceflight program. Ladies and gentlemen, please welcome Jay Foster. And Jay, I'd like you to begin by giving us some highlights of Warner Von Braun.
Okay, thank you, Ed. It was... Is it on?
There you go.
Yeah, it's on.
You're good.
Okay. Well, Wernher von Braun galvanized the nation, the world, and the Congress, and led America to the moon. It was led by his 1950s Collier's articles, which led the way. That was my first introduction as a boy in Chicago. I read those articles, and that was an interesting treat. Even today, the USA is the only nation that has sent humans beyond Earth's gravity. Von Braun built the team and the organization that could do it all, from concept through preliminary design, final design, fabrication, assembly, test, evaluation, transport, and flight. He was a people person. He conversed with everyone, the janitor, the Congress, the President of the U.S., his bosses in headquarters. He conversed with people on subjects that were important to them. To Von Braun, everyone in America was essential to the Apollo program. I mean, after all, the people had to encourage the Congress to send us the money that we needed. He had an interesting organization. He created a front office that he called the Ballantine Ring, that he had the three, Von Braun in the center, and the technical deputy, Eberhard Reis, and the management deputy, Harry Gorman. They all had their separate things, but they could, one or the other, could keep the place on an even keel when Von Braun was moving around the country. He created a technical organization. The science and engineering was really the heart of the organization. 9 discipline laboratories, initially with automatic responsibility, which the program officers didn't like a lot, but later it gave more power to the project managers. The science and engineering organization was supported by project management, program development, which became a marketing and long-range planning, and several staff functions. For management, since he required extensive travel, he required an organization that could function without him, but he also had several management practices. He had the weekly notes, which kept him well informed of what was going on in the organization while he was away. He had the staff luncheon. All of the direct reports met with him every day at lunch when he was in town. He had a staff and board, which is rather interesting. Government organizations don't have boards like industry. However, he had a monthly meeting with his staff and board. It had all the technical people, had the laboratory directors and deputies, and a selected group of the division chiefs. But depending on the agenda for the particular meeting, he brought in the experts in whatever that subject was. Von Braun really understood and accepted and really pushed for knowledge-based decisions. He did not want decisions made by the organizational superstructure, the hierarchy. He wanted to have the experts involved on any different individual subject. He had a similar arrangement with the prime contractors on a quarterly basis. The McDonnell Douglas, the Boeings, the Aerojets would come in every quarter, and we had a very detailed agenda. And again, he went through that very carefully, and he presented and wanted everybody to speak. And sometimes, depending on the problem, that would go for an hour or two, but it could also go for 2 or 3 days. And at the end, he would hold up his gavel, and he had a walnut block, but he wouldn't pound that gavel until he actually heard from the last minute. He would look around the room one last time to see if anybody had any comments, because he wanted every input before you made that decision. As part of that, I really did appreciate my first 6 years working in the manufacturing laboratory, in the science and engineering organization, because I believe that understanding the science and engineering part of the organization made the rest possible. I want to say a few words also about the Washington years. Tom Payne, the NASA administrator, could see the end of Apollo after the first lunar landing. And looking at the end of the Apollo program, he wanted to have somebody think about the future. And Marshall had always been involved in long-range planning for the man flight portion of NASA. So Von Braun went to Washington, and he took two people with him, myself and Frank Williams. And we went up there and spent the first year, we only stayed about a year and a quarter. In the first year, we really worked on developing the plan. We went to every NASA center. We called in all the aerospace companies and some of the government organizations like the Weather Service and Military Sealift Command. And we put together this plan. And Tom Payne and Von Braun decided they wanted to have a meeting. And we had a long 4-day meeting in Wallops to discuss the plan. And subsequently, Tom Payne took the plan to Mr. Nixon in the White House. Mr. Nixon was up to his ears in Watergate at the time and basically told Tom Payne that he really wasn't interested in a long-range plan and that NASA had a lot on its plate, both in aeronautics and space, and Tom Payne should concentrate on the things on his plate. So when Tom Payne came back from that meeting, that was a real downer. And some people in Huntsville always thought and talked about occasionally that Von Braun really didn't want to go to Washington, but in my complete understanding is he was really excited about it. He really liked the dream about the future. And for the first year prior to the Tom Payne meeting with Nixon, everything was great. And when he came back, when Tom Payne came back from that Nixon meeting, shortly thereafter, Tom Payne decided to jump ship and he went to GE as a vice president in charge of their nuclear program. Shortly thereafter, Warner decided to jump ship and go to Fairchild Industries. And I called Eberhard, and Eberhard welcomed me back to come back to Marshall.
Jay, I'm going to leave you at that point. We'll come back and check up with you on a couple other issues, okay? We got a little time factor
going
here, okay? Heidi Weber Collier, is a U.S. Army civilian employee at Redstone Arsenal, daughter of the original German rocket team member Fritz Weber, who specialized in guidance control. Heidi has developed a passion for keeping the team families connected and champions the legacy of American and German rocket pioneers. She will share a few memories of her early years growing up in Huntsville during the beginning of the space age in the 1950s and 60s. So please welcome Heidi Weber Collier. And by the way, she works for the Army and her father worked for the Army.
Yes, I like the irony of that. So he worked for them about 13 years and so far I have 18. One more to go. So yes, I was away from Huntsville, moved away for college, came back and developed this passion, but I'll get to that towards the end. First of all, do you know the background, the story? I'm guessing a lot of you do, but some may not, that the team was kind of recruited by the Army. They ended up in El Paso, Fort Bliss at first, and they worked there for about 5 years. My father came in January of 1948. My sister and mother came, and my sister's here. They arrived in September of 48, and Heidi arrived in 49. So they kind of had a baby boom out there in Fort Bliss. They were writing a lot of project proposals, working on rebuilding the V-2s from the parts that were brought over and so forth. And then it was Senator John Sparkman that facilitated the move to Huntsville, Alabama in 1950. So we ended up here, and so my part, I have no technical background in this wonderful book and the accomplishments of these two gentlemen, but my, as Ed said, I've developed a passion for keeping that. They just, it was an amazing time and amazing accomplishments. And so when I moved back here in 1998, I decided that we all needed to stay in contact with each other and stay in touch. And so that's when I developed that passion. But growing up was easy. I had the easy part. It was just make good grades, play in the neighborhood, go swimming. So nice, easy, comfortable growing up years. Ride your bicycle to go see friends. So not the exciting things they were doing out here at the Arsenal. And I asked Doretta Schlitt, in fact, one time, I said, why didn't I pay better attention when I was growing up to what was going on? She said, Heidi, we didn't know. We, the spouses, didn't know what was going on. It was all top secret. So finally, this aha moment, yes, they couldn't discuss what was going on. So, okay, I'm released from not having paid better attention. So, but wonderful years growing up, just very, very easy growing up. And again, my challenge was to make good grades. So I tried to do that dutifully. The next thing was throughout my part, and you'll have to buy the book to read who all is in there, and Uwe Huta is here today too, who wrote a part for this. This is actually the title of our section that you entitled, Ed, is What Was It Like to Grow Up with a Rocket Scientist? So we each gave our contributions on that, but throughout mine you will hear about various German families that we were closely connected with. It might be because we lived close to them. Generally, the German community stayed in the Blossomwood area and on Monsanto. So mostly the families stayed in Huntsville. Once they arrived here, they stayed in Huntsville. Quite a few ended up going to Florida because, of course, the launch complex there. And I have a friend, my former neighbor, growing up, Hannelore Knote is with me today. And her father was Dr. Heinz Knote. And they moved to Florida down in 1958. So you see, we still stay connected. But when I returned to Huntsville in 1998, it was, and this is perfect, because it's Ed Buckbee and Jim Splawn who were standing outside in front of this building, and that's when I had my aha moment on that. You two were like little boys talking about, it was still all exciting and new and fun for you. Brooks Moore is another one. And I said, that's it. That's the way they were able to get to the moon in 10 years. They put those war wounds aside. They didn't look at them as being Germans. It was just, you had a goal, a common goal. And you put all of that aside and you just worked well together. And so that's how it was accomplished. So that's my
thank you, Heidi. We'll be back to you too. Jim Splawn, an industrial engineer, is the father and the longtime manager of the Marshall Space Flight Center's famous neutral buoyancy simulator, which we often refer to as the tank. Splawn enjoyed a 30-year career at Marshall, and he will now share with us some of his experiences working with the Von Braun team, and I specifically want him to talk about what was it like to train astronauts to do what he wanted them to do underwater in preparation for flying in space. Jim.
Thank you. 50 years ago, 1966, I had been on Marshall Space Flight Center about 4.5 years. In 1966, we knew that we were going to the moon and return safely. So some of us in what was the manufacturing engineering lab. And manufacturing, of course, implies that that's where machinists, metal benders, welders, etc., resided and performed. In that environment, there were three or four of us guys that would open our brown bag every day for lunch, and we'd talk about what are we going to do after we go to the moon and return. So we began to play with that idea, knowing that man was going back into space again and was going to do work. Okay, in a weightless environment, how do you stay in one spot and still have two hands free to do work? So we started playing with that idea. We had no building, we had no pressure suits, we had no health monitoring system, we had nothing but a dream. And so, a year later, in the fall of 1967, we had scavenged enough hardware that we really looked like we had raided a salvage yard, and there is some truth in that. But we did have a tank that had been abandoned out behind one of the manufacturing buildings that was filled with water because it was used in explosive forming of some components. We did have some pressure suits because we had gone to the U.S. Navy since we couldn't get any out of Houston. We went to the U.S. Navy and got high-altitude flying suits. Two of us went out, spent 2 days there. They trained us in dry simulation, also put us in a swimming pool and taught us how to survive once you start taking on water in a pressure suit, get the helmet off, et cetera, et cetera. So we had some ingredients to work with. Another few months, and we thought we had performed enough that it was time to let the cat out of the bag. So we called Bonnie Holmes, Dr. Von Braun's very competent secretary, and said, "Ms. Bonnie, can you please get Dr. Von Braun to come see us in a few days? We want to show him a simulation of weightlessness." In about 2 weeks, he came. He watched. And he came back 2 weeks later and said, "I want to be the test subject." So we put him in a pressure suit. We had a little bit of trouble getting his large head through the neck ring. But by manipulating his nose just a little bit to the side, we got him inside the suit. He did superbly so. All underwater communications work, heart monitoring system work in cooperation with the Med Center. And we did not drown nor hurt the center director. Whenever he came out of the tank, he said, yeah, tis good, keep going. And I'm sorry, I'm sure I slaughtered that, but hopefully it communicates what he said. Here we were, four grunt guys out there doing things way beyond what we knew to do, but yet we had a dream, and he endorsed it, and he says, y'all, keep going. 2 months later after that, he came back again to be another pressure suit test subject, but he brought with him a guy named Gordon Cooper, an astronaut named Gordon Cooper. Well, guess what? From that day on, smooth sailing for the underwater simulator system. That was in October of 67. In November of 67, 1 month later, the decision was made that we will build a big tank, 75 feet in diameter, 40 feet deep, 1.3 million gallons of water, as clear as could be. And we were going to do astronaut training for the Skylab program. 11 months later, the tank was complete because it was a design and build in-house project. So 11 months later, we were complete with fabrication and installation. By November of that year, we were operational. And then you just had to hang on. Skylab Project Office, all the time that we had been playing with how to simulate the weightlessness of space, they had been defining all of the parameters for the Skylab program, which was man's first space station. For 3 years, we trained 16 astronauts. 9 of them were prime crew, 6 of them were backup. Of those 9 crewmen, they would take 3 individual missions. First mission was 30 days, second mission, 60 days, the third mission was 90 days, total of 188 days. What was the purpose of Skylab? To define what the limits were on the human body, with the mental capabilities that you have in 1G, does it erode in any fashion with extended weightlessness? then also, how can you perform in that environment continuously inside a space station? It all worked superbly well. We went to launch on May of 2013, Skylab was launched. You may remember the history that as we were going through max Q, which is dynamic, maximum dynamic pressure, there was a weakness in the outer skin. Some of the outer skin peeled away, taking with it one of the solar panels, and it's somewhere in the bottom of the ocean, I guess, today. But we still went on through launch and went on orbit. But immediately, the ground station started seeing temperature rises up to 120, 125, 130 degrees. We also saw that we're getting no power. So the launch for the first three-man team did not launch the next day as planned, but some 2 weeks later, they did launch. And that two-week period, in my opinion, is one of the greatest performances of the Marshall Space Flight Center. We started with no real knowledge of what exactly had happened, and whenever that skin ripped away, what did it take with it? We looked at data, engineering did, and at the neutral buoyancy area, we were busy preparing for everything and anything that could happen to correct the problem. Whenever the tools were developed, we tested them underwater. Whenever procedures were planned, we tested them underwater. First with our own test subjects, and finally with the flight crew. So we were running 24 hours a day, 7 days a week, for a lot of people. I think that's the longest time that I personally have ever been without sleep, but our families brought us, with the kids, they would bring us a change of clothes, and they'd bring us a hot meal, and that's just the way we work. We were committed because of the commitment of the center to its defined program. Flight crew launched, they got on orbit, the tools that had been performed, the procedures that had been written, we were duplicating underwater because we had air-to-ground communications directly with the flight crew at that point. And the second solar panel that was trapped with a strap was freed, and so it did deploy. The solar panels dropped. We had power, and then we went inside and we put out a poor man's umbrella that went out into space and shielded the exposure of the skin from the sun. Temperatures started coming down, and we were home free, so to speak, from a very, very bad day. But Skylab survived and completed its total missions. One of the flight crew, while they were doing a great deal of exterior simulations, commented, "You know, this is just like the big tank at Marshall, except it's a lot deeper."
All right, Jim, I want to thank you. We'll come back a little later. We're running a little short on time.
I'm through anyway.
Thank you.
All right, thank you. Margaret von Braun is like her father, both a scientist and a teacher. She was born not far away at Huntsville Hospital and made her home here for many years. Margaret moved to Idaho in 1977, where she worked at the University of Idaho in Moscow as professor of environmental science. She retired after 31 years as dean of the College of Graduate Studies. She has also worked with and founded environmentally focused nonprofit environmental organizations, encouraging governments to clean up hazardous waste sites. Ladies and gentlemen, please welcome Dr. Margaret von Braun. And you're welcome to share some memories with us tonight, since this is your home.
It is home, and I'm glad to be home.
Huntsville hasn't lost one iota of its hospitality, and I'm just thrilled to be here and to congratulate and help support Ed with the release of his latest book. Today I got an extensive tour of the center and got to visit the archives, kind of the bowels of some of the stuff behind the center, and I'm still feeling a little bit overwhelmed by memories and by the history of this place. But really one of the most impressive things that I observed today was the absolute crowd of visitors and enthusiastic space campers, and this isn't even the weekend. They tell me it gets even more crowded as the weekend comes. And I think our father would have been just overwhelmed and thrilled to see such enthusiasm for the future that this place embodies. My memories of my father, of course, really aren't about his leadership or management style. Like Heidi, I wasn't really paying attention either. My memories are of his laughter, of our trips to Gunnersville Lake every Sunday when he was in town. That was our family day to get away from everything. He was devoted to us. And as kids, we found he really wasn't that hard to manipulate. The only really non-negotiable thing in our family was a commitment to our education. And same thing Heidi said. I mean, it was you go to school and you get good grades and then you can do whatever you want. He was interested in so many things. Of course, space was number one, but closely followed by history and music. So he didn't really care what we studied, but we had to be committed to school. And I ended up as an environmental engineer. This was a field that he literally considered sort of the exhaust end of everything he was interested in. But his interest in Earth imaging was a place where our fields overlapped. And I've actually used a lot of Earth images in chasing down pollution and visiting horrible hazardous waste sites all over the world. I sometimes laugh at myself and think of all the beautiful places he took me scuba diving, and I ended up traveling around visiting waste sites. So the scuba diving, you know, really followed on a lot of those early tank exercises that Jim was describing. That was good practice. Yesterday, I had lunch with my mother, and some of you may remember her. She's still very strong and feisty, and she doesn't mince words. So I wanted to share some of her stories as well as mine. I asked her how she would describe how he got things done, how he got the team together, and how what he might be like to work for. And she looked at me, and to no great surprise, made it very clear that she did not work for him. And then she said, really, it was simple. He was surrounded by the smartest, most committed people in his team. And that's what it was. They found smart people, they built this team, and that team stuck together. He came with that amazing team from Germany, and after they moved to Huntsville, this place really became a magnet for smart, committed people who came from all over the place. People with a commitment, maybe even an obsession, probably an obsession, to go to the moon. My mother mentioned people like the late Bonnie Holmes, his secretary, who drove an hour every day from Eva, Alabama, to work at Marshall. This magnet for smart people, and it really meant that the Marshall Space Flight Center stole people from agencies, from contractors, even from local businesses. In my mother's case, the consequences were quite practical ones. One day she told me that she had to call a plumber. And she called a local plumber, and the boss said, sorry, your husband hired away all my best plumbers. So there she was with a leaky pipe. My parents started their marriage in America, leaving the war behind, to be in a country of the future. And they were such proud Americans. They were immigrants. She arrived in El Paso with 6 porcelain cups. He brought 30 books. And in Huntsville, when by the time they moved here, it was clear that their English was much more British than Southern. I never tasted grits, I never tasted collards until I left home. But they never felt more welcome than they did here in Huntsville, just like I feel here today, coming home. This German group, as it was known, was really close-knit. Many of the families spoke only German at home. Their houses were furnished and decorated in German style. My mother said to me yesterday, "The nerds didn't stick out. They were all nerds." And I just got to revisit with Mrs. Stuhlinger. Dr. Stuhlinger and Dr. Hooter made their own furniture, which my father thought was a waste of good time, but that's the kind of folks they were. Even my parents' first house, the first house that they didn't rent here in Huntsville on McClung Street, was a demonstration of expedience. While many of the other German scientists designed and even built their own houses, my parents ordered a house from a lumber company in Gadsden. It was a cedar pre-built house. It arrived on a truck. It was mounted on a cinder block foundation. It was done, they moved in, and they went back to work. That team was built on that kind of hard work, a commitment, a mutual respect, and a refusal to fail. And that's who I think this greatest space generation really was. But let's be clear, that's the greatest space generation so far. The future, the next great space generation, has been in this building all day and in the Space Center, Rocket Center all day. They are the kids who will walk on Mars and perhaps walk on planets that we haven't even discovered yet. If my father were here now, I think he would be hooked on all of the sorts of technology toys that we'd enjoy. He'd have the latest iPhone. He would be driving a Tesla. Like many of us, I think he would be amazed and disappointed that we still can't put metal in a microwave. But he'd definitely be looking to the future. He would be looking at what this place represents, the opportunities it provides for young people and the lessons that it spreads around the world. So I thank all of you for being part of that effort, for being part of the greatest past space generation and the future greatest space generation. And again, I congratulate Ed on putting it all in print. Thank you.
Margaret, thank you. How about a hand for all of our members of panelists, please. And since I cut Jay off quite early, I've got a question for him. Why was Warner Von Braun the greatest leader in this business?
Well, you know, it's hard to say. It's difficult to say, but it's a combination of personality and drive and the fact that he wanted to listen to what everybody had to say. I mean, I mentioned that earlier, but he really was interested in what others had to say, and he wanted to have all of that knowledge before the decision was cast. I have one little anecdote that sort of illustrates his personality a bit. This was in 1975, towards late 75. He was on the board of directors of a Decatur bank, so he was down in Huntsville. And I got on the airplane going to Washington, and there he sat in first class. And he said, "Come talk to me." So obviously I sat down and we chatted for a minute, and then stewardess came by and said, "Sir, you have to get in the back. You have a coach seat." So I proceeded to get up and walk to the back, but he also got up and walked and followed me. And we sat in coach, both of us sat in coach, and we got to talk all the way to Washington, a 2-hour chat. That was the last time I ever saw him. But I think it illustrates his philosophy and his personality. He was just a great man, and I think his personality and the way he talked to people really contributed to the fact that the team really stuck together, and they really appreciated it, and they really worked for him because they wanted to, not because he ordered them to. In fact, I never remember him ever giving a direct order. He would talk to people and arrive at a conclusion through the discussion, whether it was his idea or whether it was your idea. It was normally his idea because he had such a great intellect, but nevertheless, he wanted to hear your ideas before he got to a conclusion.
Now we're gonna take questions from the audience. Do we have a mic somewhere?
Mic right here.
Oh, excuse me.
Do you have a question?
Questions?
No questions. No questions?
I've got one little story I'll share with you. Warner Von Braun managed billions of dollars, but when he traveled, he did not have any money on his person. He would forget his wallet. So we would go to the restaurant, have our soup and salad, a sandwich, and as we were about to leave, Warner would begin doing this, which was the signal to get ready to pick up the tab, which we did. We come back, we report that expense to Bonnie. She would have a check prepared. Warner Von Braun would sign the check, send it to us. Nobody would cash the check. They ended up on the wall all over the Marshall Space Flight Center building, and Bonnie could not balance the check.